This is Ham Radio Now, episode 136. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. If you've been a subscriber to CQ Magazine, you know something has gone a little bit awry up there in Hicksville, New York. This is the last issue that has been published. It's the December issue, the last one anyone's gotten in their mailboxes. And it is now in the middle of March. So something has gone wrong. And in a moment, we're going to talk to CQ editor Rich Moseson, W2VU, and find out just what that was and what is coming up for CQ Magazine. But first, as usual, I need to point back at Arvin. I have appointed Arvin as the chief financial officer for ARVN and Ham Radio Now. In that position, that exalted position, he's responsible for all the finances, and he wants me to remind you to stop by the website, hamradionow.tv, click on his picture, and if you enjoy the programs, get something valuable out of them, make a contribution. Our goal is $10 a year for all the content that we put out, over 50 programs a year. $10 a year, we'd like to get that from 10,000 hams. We're a long way from doing that. But things have been going fairly well, especially once we released program 135 on Gary Wadke, WW8N's tower case in Ohio. That seems to have resonated with a lot of people. So I'd like to bring you programs that are important like that one, and I think like this one will be. So on my Skype line is editor of CQ Magazine, Rich Moseson, W2VU. So Rich, thank you for coming on the program today.
It's always nice to chat with you, Gary.
And I was trying to think of a good, concise, and pithy way of introducing the program or the topic we're going to talk about today. And I came up with one as I was working on the exercise bike this morning. This is what I came up with. Rich, what the heck?
It's very imaginative and creative.
Okay, so maybe I need to do just a little bit better than that. So,
well, that's okay.
I think for most people, this is the last physical issue of CQ Magazine we have seen.
Yes.
And it is December, and it is currently January. It is March 11th. So you're going to have an explanation for that. And here's a physical issue of Popular Communications. And that is, as a physical magazine, that is going away. And you will have an explanation for that. So let me let you begin and tell us what's going on.
Okay, let me start with the good news, which is that the January issue is in the mail, finally. And it will be followed quickly by February and then by a combined March-April issue, which hopefully will get us back on track schedule-wise.
So there's going to be physical issues coming for the ones that have been missing so far.
Yes.
And the digital issues were, I don't know if they were on time, but they've been out.
The digital issues have basically been on time. The March issue is not out yet because we needed to pull that back to make the changes to bring it into being a March-April issue. And we also didn't want to then have a two-month gap on the digital side between the March-April issue coming out at the usual time at the beginning of March and then nothing till the beginning of May for the May issue. So that should be out this week, hopefully tomorrow, and that'll be for March and April, so we've got basically 6 weeks on either side there to not have too long a gap in between issues on the digital side as well as the print side. It's bad enough on the print side.
Okay, so I guess what everybody wants to know now is what happened, you know, why the big delay?
It's kind of goes back to Popular Communications that you were holding up and our other magazines, World Radio Online and CQVHF. Basically, with the economy being the way it is, the very deep recession and very slow, dragged out recovery, those magazines have not been pulling their own weight. And along with the economic questions on communications, there are changes in the listening and monitoring hobby as well, which we can get into. But the real bottom line there is that we're subsidizing those magazines, and last summer it started to get to the point where it was affecting our ability to get CQ out the door on time. Those delays were not as significant as these are, but for the first couple of months, we just kind of hoped things would get better next month, and unfortunately they didn't, they got worse, which led to the variety of actions that we've taken to try to get ourselves back on track and back in a way that is sustainable, which was not before. What we have decided to do, well, let me talk about the listening hobby first and where that's at, because this is a big part of what we're going, where we're heading with this.
Okay, so that is primarily what was being addressed by CQ or by Popular Communications.
That's right.
Which just had its, 30th anniversary last year sometime.
That's right. It was a good long run. Unfortunately, there are some negative changes in that hobby. There are more and more, or actually fewer and fewer, international broadcasters out there. More and more countries, governments feel that they can reach their intended audiences at far less expense over the internet or via satellite feeds. I disagree strongly with that, but that's what they've decided, and they have abandoned their shortwave broadcasts. In addition, on the monitoring side for VHF, UHF scanning, more and more public safety agencies are going to encrypted communications, not just digital. The technology is able to keep up on digital and shared trunking, things like that. But they're going more and more to encrypted communications for very valid security and safety issues. It's unfortunate that we live in a world where we have to worry about terrorists and things like that, but it's a fact of life. And
a lot of scanner listeners get very upset with encrypted communications. They feel like one of their rights to listen has been violated, but then probably not.
I would agree with that on a on one level, because as Americans, we do have a right to know what our public servants are doing and what they're saying over the air, and we have a right to listen to radio transmissions. Unfortunately, there is a parallel reality that sometimes there are bad people out there who will take advantage of those communications to make it easier for them to either do more bad things or get away with the bad stuff that they've done.
Yeah, I've always enjoyed public safety monitoring, but I've also always wondered, come on, if I can hear that the cops are about to stop someplace, so can the crooks. How stupid are the crooks? Well, from all the TV shows we've seen, they can be pretty stupid, but I guess not all of them have been stupid. They've been tuning in.
So there's a balance that the public safety agencies have to draw between the public safety and the public's right to hear what their employees and their protective agencies are up to. More and more of them are opting to lean more toward security than accessibility and are encrypting their communications. Whether it's right or wrong is kind of irrelevant. We can have great discussions about it, and I'd be happy to do that with anybody down the road. But the bottom line is that there's less and less to listen to on your scanner that's in the clear.
And evidently that's been hitting the subscription level to Popular Communications.
More than that, it's been hitting the manufacturers and dealers who advertise with us. And they've been, we've had a loss in advertising by companies going out of the market or cutting back what they do and how they do it. And there's been there was an erosion of the subscriber base, but it was more on the advertising side than on the subscriber side. If the ads had stayed where they had been prior to the recession, and the readership base declined at the rate that it was declining, then we wouldn't be in the situation that we're in today.
Yeah, I guess GRE is the big name that had pretty much disappeared last year. They supplied Radio Shack, and they were in the background as a manufacturer. Then a couple of years ago, they came up with doing their own nameplate. I think they still sold stuff through Radio Shack. And then suddenly just pulled out.
Right. And now, of course, Radio Shack is closing 1,100 stores. So even that source is going away for a lot of people. So that all combined to create a smaller universe, both for readers and for advertisers, in the marketplace that Popcom served. And it got to the point where it wasn't economically sustainable anymore. And that led us to deciding that we had to do something. But at the same time, we were thinking, how many hams really got their start just in ham radio? Very few, in my experience. Most of us start out in some other part of the economy, whether it was broadcast band DXing, which is how I got started, or shortwave listening, or scanner monitoring, or CB. Everybody that I know of started in some other part of the radio hobby.
Yeah, or a combination.
You know, yes,
probably typically
moved
multiple
into
things.
Ham radio. Yeah. And many, many hams have not abandoned those other pursuits as they've gotten into ham radio. Ham radio has become an addition to them, and they're still active in shortwave listening, scanning monitoring, you name it, within the radio hobby. And through CQ, we haven't been able to serve that part of their radio interest. So we realized that a lot of our CQ readers are also interested in these other aspects of the radio hobby. So by moving the content from Popcom into CQ, we could help to better serve them.
Okay. I don't think we've explained what's actually going to happen. So
do that.
Yeah. Okay. So the magazines are not totally going away. They're going away as individual magazines, but the content, at least some of it,
right,
is going to stick around.
A lot of the content from Popular Communications, from CQVHF, and from World Radio Online is being merged into what we've called CQ Plus, which is a 50 to 60 page supplement to our digital edition. And I want to be clear on this because there's been some confusion. We're not adding to the print edition. We're adding to the digital edition. And all variety of columns and features that would have been in these other magazines are now appearing in this CQ Plus digital supplement. It is part and parcel of the digital edition of CQ. You just reach what is the end of the print edition, and the digital edition just keeps on going for another 50 pages.
Yep. Let me punch up the digital edition of the February issue. Okay. And we'll move on over to the, I can get there. Yeah, there
okay,
we go.
If you go to, there's the table of contents. So that whole right-hand page of the table of contents is everything that is in CQ Plus. On the digital side only, a lot of stuff that would have been in any one of the other three magazines.
Yeah, so let me take a look at what this was the contents. Actually, I got a camera, I can stick that on. This was the contents from the print edition from back in December. Mm-hmm. And just an ad on the other side.
Right.
And so now there's the contents from the digital edition of February. And as you're saying, all this stuff over here is CQ Plus. All of
right.
this
everything,
is...
Right. And everything on the left-hand page is in both the print and digital.
Yep. Well, will the print subscribers, the people looking at print, see this page?
Just
that page.
They will see just that page.
But none of these articles will be available to them in print.
That's correct.
Okay. So it's sort of a teaser for them to say, here's what you're missing, guys.
Yes, we hope that they will add in the digital edition. We've made it available at a very reasonable rate for our print subscriber. It's only $1 an issue to also get the digital, and you get all that additional content. If you've still got the magazine up there, if you go to page, I think, 116 or something like that, you'll see the end of... If you go to the advertiser's index, which I think is probably the easiest way to get there, you'll see what is basically the end of the magazine. Now you're at the end of CQ Plus there.
So what I was noticing here is we're seeing like 164 pages. There were 110
yes.
pages in the December print edition. So there's 164
right.
of them here. And I want to get to page 116.
Something around there. Basically the last page of the advertiser's index would be the last page of the print edition. That looks good.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the last page of the print edition. When people get their February print edition, that's where it's going to end. You're going to turn that page, and it's going to be the back cover ad.
Okay, and when I turn the page here
now
is...
Now when you turn the page on the digital edition, you get...
Okay, so these are the columns... amalgamated from the old...
Right. Washington Beat used to be in Popular Communications. And next there, you've got a feature that I happened to write for Popular Communications that ended up in CQ Plus on a conference on the future of AM broadcasting. Obviously something that CQ itself would not have covered in the past.
Yeah. Is there a future to AM broadcasting?
You got to read those two articles because yep. the second one is a companion piece on the FCC's moves to try to assure a future for AM broadcasting.
They keep trying. It has not been successful so far. All right. So we're going to move.
So basically where we're at with that is that the other three magazines have been merged into CQ Plus. People with subscriptions to those magazines have been given, if they were print subscribers to PopCom or CQVHF, they get both print and digital subscription for however many issues are remaining in their subscription term. World Radio Online subscribers were already digital-only subscribers, and their number of remaining issues simply transfers over to the digital CQ subscription. We do have some people for whom we've had mailing addresses only, but not email addresses. So if you are a PopCom or CQVHF print subscriber and you did not get notification about the February issue of CQ and CQ Plus Digital, please contact our office to make sure that we get your email address linked with your subscription record so that you will be getting that digital edition of CQ and CQ Plus.
So how should people contact you? I guess if they email you, you'll get their email address.
True. Our email address for this is circulation@cq-amateur-radio.com. And we have a toll-free number for circulation, which is 800-853-9797. And that gets answered during regular East Coast business hours.
Yeah, say that number again. There was a little Skype bubble in there.
Sure. 1-800-853-9797.
Okay. I'll put that up on the screen, but some folks are listening in just audio. They haven't been seeing all these beautiful pictures that we've been putting up. So for the folks listening in audio, apologize. You can't. This is a TV show, sort of. All right. So what has the reaction to this been so far? You have sort of an explanation of things in the February issue, but unfortunately, unless
it's
they were
been seen.
If they were only a print subscriber, they didn't get to see it. So,
well, people who, if you go to our webpage, we have links to both the January and February digital editions freely available. So, and we've been directing people there who have been contacting us. So a lot of our print subscribers who have contacted us or who have visited our webpage will have seen that.
Again, that's a free download. You can,
yes,
you can look at it for free. Is it still,
yep,
part of the Zinio that the regular magazine comes in, or
yeah,
is it a PDF?
It's through Zinio, but it's set up so that you don't have to have an account there or sign in or anything. So it's a free view of January and February digital editions.
Okay, so that's a good way to preview what being digital is like.
Right.
Yeah, are you still getting a lot of complaints, people that are not happy with things being digital, that they want to make sure they still get their physical magazine?
There are a lot of people who prefer print magazines. I'm one of them. And we're happy that we're finally able to get those print magazines moving and out to people. But basically, you asked about the reaction of people. When they've talked to us and we've had a chance to explain what's going on, their basic concern seems to be that, oh, I was afraid I was going to be losing my favorite magazine. I'm glad to hear that it's just a bump in the road and that you're doing things to get past it. I know there are a lot of people out there on the internet who haven't bothered talking to us and trying to find out what's really going on and speculating on their own. But the internet is you know, as we all know, the internet is a prime source for accurate information at all times.
It's my go-to place.
Yeah. people who have made the effort to talk to us have gotten an explanation of what's going on. And I would say 99.5% of them are satisfied with that explanation. It's a reality of where we're at today, and we're doing our best to get around it.
When did CQ get started? When was the first issue published?
January 1945. This is our 70th year of continuous publication, and we have every intention of getting through it to our 70th anniversary and beyond.
Yep. And when did you become the editor?
I've been the editor since the end of 1999.
So you've had a long run yourself.
Yeah, I've been coming up on 15 years now.
We would hate to have lost CQ. 73 magazine came and went. I think they stopped publishing in the early 2000s sometime, I think.
I believe so. I think it was 2003.
Yep. And I've listened to you talk at Hamfests, and you have always been very bullish on the future of ham radio. I ascribe some of that to self-interest, because you don't want a self-fulfilling prophecy of gloom and doom for ham radio, but it's important for ham radio to survive, for your livelihood, for, you know, CQ magazine to survive. But what's the connection between the health of ham radio, one of the statistics we can see is licensing. And licensing continues to go up. But as you mentioned in the article, subscriptions to magazines, to ARL memberships, to radio club memberships has not kept pace with the number of licenses. So where are all those new people going? What are they doing?
A lot of them are on the internet, and I'm just turning off my phone here so it doesn't pack during our talk. One of the interesting things that we've found is that our fans on our Facebook page tend to be considerably younger than the demographics for the people who have sent in our reply cards on our surveys when we had those reply cards in the magazines. It was very interesting. The cards, the people who sent in the cards tended to be mostly in their, the biggest group was in the in their 60s. The people who responded online, the biggest group was in their 50s. And the people who were reaching through Facebook tend to be in their 40s or even younger. So there are a lot of younger hams out there. They have a different way of connecting with each other, and social media is one of those primary ways of doing that. So we have to go where they are. They can't necessarily be expected to show up at radio club meetings, particularly if they are not interesting meetings, and a lot of them, unfortunately, are not. There are clubs that have interesting programs and interesting activities, and they have thriving memberships of young people as well as older people. So they're out there, and but they're not connecting in the traditional way. So we have to make a greater effort to reach out to them and engage them in on their turf rather than trying to drag them over to ours.
So you're seeing them on Facebook, you're seeing them online. Are you seeing them subscribe to the digital editions of the magazines?
We don't have enough statistics yet to see, to get a sense of the demographics of the digital subscribers. The unfortunately, the people who tended to respond to the surveys either online as opposed to with the cards was a much smaller group, because I think as the ages show, the older readers perhaps have more time to sit and fill out a card and mail it back in. So the whole number of responses to the surveys has declined a bit. So it's hard to separate out in any meaningful way the specific demographics from the people who are subscribing to the digital edition and responding to the survey.
You'd probably like to hear from people, though. And I wish,
I wish
I could tell you that I could give you access to the young audience, but I look at the demographics for this program that I get off of YouTube, and it's the bubble starts in the 40s, it peaks in the 50s and 60s, and falls off fast in the 70s. So we're not talking to any young kids here either. I wish we were. And I'm on YouTube. Come on, I'm on YouTube.
Yeah, it's a challenge for all of us. And but you know, it's. I've looked back at some past issues of the magazine and just my own history in ham radio. And I've seen back in the 1950s letters and editorials about getting young people into the hobby, and that it was a die-off with all these old people. And when I started getting active things in the late 70s, there was the same attitude of, well, we've got to get the young people in because the hobby won't survive unless we do. And now the young people that we brought in the late 70s are the old timers who are now complaining that there are no young people coming in. Ham radio has always been attractive to a very small, slight population to begin with. While we may think that back in the 1950s and 60s, in the so-called golden age of ham radio, that every kid in junior high and high school was either a ham or wanted to be a ham, it wasn't the case. They were the nerds. They were the nerds in the 70s. They're the nerds now. Being a nerd is more popular now than in the past. And we continue to appeal to a very small slice of the population. But you know, I've had the privilege over the last 10 to 15 years of being a judge on the Newsline Young Ham of the Year Award competition. And we make up in quality what we may lack in quantity. The young people who are getting into ham radio and are getting involved are superb. They are just fantastic people with all sorts of stuff to contribute. And they are contributing in a variety of different ways. When I go through those nominations every year, and when I get to meet the winners at the Huntsville Hamfest every year, I am always totally encouraged about our future, because these are the future leaders of our hobby, and I think we're going to be in pretty good shape.
Well, we do have the quality that you're talking about, because I've talked to the last 2 years' worth of Young Ham of the Year winners on the show at the Huntsville Hamfest. And yes, they're very impressive, but I'm guessing we also need some of that quantity.
And one of the places that we can go, and, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on that combines ham radio with other activities. For example, high-altitude balloon, weather balloons that carry all sorts of experiments called near space. There's a lot of ham radio involvement in those activities, and a lot of young people who are involved with this near space ballooning get their ham licenses as part of what they're doing with the balloon and tracking and recovery and things like that, or sending amateur television pictures back down from 90,000 feet. This is a growth area. Satellite building is becoming more accessible to anybody and everybody. There's I was just reading about a satellite that's due to be launched up to the space station on the next supply mission called KickSat. And this is a crowdfunded satellite that inside is carrying 200 little tiny satellites on a circuit board the size of a saltine cracker. They're built around tiny microprocessors, and those are going to be deployed from, and the people who donated money to fund the project get to design an experiment that's going to fly on this satellite and be on these tiny little nano satellites that are launched from the bigger one. And those are going to operate on amateur radio frequencies. So being able to have any kind of access and control of them requires you to have contact with amateur radio. To hopefully have a license as well.
I've seen that, and those things are extremely cool. And I've talked to some of the AMSAT guys about the projects they're doing with the colleges and schools. Do you think we're parlaying that into as much as we can in terms of getting people into ham radio, other than just saying, oh, the ham radio part is cool, but I don't really want to be a ham?
Well, that's up to the individual people who are working with these students as to how they present it and how much they encourage it. You can't look at an organization or a broad group of people and make a judgment on that. It's up to each individual how well they present and promote amateur radio with younger people. Another aspect of potential growth is the maker movement. This is really catching fire in a lot of ways. People are getting back into building stuff. Hams are getting back into building stuff. And there's a tremendous cross-pollination available in the maker movement. Some of the maker groups are outgrowths of amateur radio clubs. Some of them have a fair number of hams in them. For example, one of the premier maker groups, the NYC Resistor Group in New York City, is full of hams and high-profile hams. And they've made no secret of the benefits that they derive from ham radio as part of what they do as makers.
Now, I was kind of wondering about the maker deal. I know that we have wanted to worm our way into their world, but I've wondered how how responsive they've been. Are they really catching the idea that ham radio has something to offer that nothing else does in terms of maker technology, or are they just saying, you're invading our space, dude?
Again, I think it's a matter of individual presentation and how things are approached and promoted, and I don't think you can make broad generalizations.
So what do we do are we doing a good job in making our approaches in these two areas to makers and to young people, or do we pretty much suck at that?
I think we're doing a better job with the near space activities and related things, and with satellites. And the maker movement is our next fertile area for trying to recruit people. And I think that has just started, and we will hopefully see some more success in doing that in the future.
Okay. We didn't talk very much about CQ-VHF, which has also been pulled into the new CQ+. CQ-VHF was a quarterly and concentrated mostly on the more esoteric aspects of VHF. I think, in most hams, their touch to VHF is FM and repeaters. And I wrote the FM and repeater column for a couple of years in CQ-VHF. But that wasn't the big part of what the magazine was all about. It was aiming for a very limited demographic of hams that do something besides repeaters on VHF, and that's just not very big. What's happening with CQ-VHF going into CQ+?
Again, like with the other magazines, a fair number of the columns will be migrating in there. Try to remember right offhand what's going into the first couple of issues. The first one, the February one, didn't have anything from CQ-VHF because it wasn't time yet on the production schedule for the next group of columns to come in. If you remember back in the late 1990s when we started CQ-VHF, it was a monthly and it was a more broad-based magazine aiming for really reaching some of the newer hams who are mostly active on FM and repeaters and trying to expose them to what the rest of VHF and UHF had to offer in addition to FM and repeaters. And I've got to say, we didn't do a very good job of reaching them. We weren't very effective in that regard. The people who did want the magazine and did enjoy the magazine were the dedicated VHFers with the high-tech interests. And those are the people who, during the 2 years, remember back in 2000, we had merged it once before into CQ, and a lot of the columns moved over from their public service and how it works. They've remained in CQ, but there was a ceaseless demand for 2 years for bringing back the magazine in some way, shape, or form. But the people who were demanding that were not the repeater operators who said, I want to learn more about what else is out there. But it was the people who were already involved in what else is out there, whether it's VHF DXing, moon bounce, meteor scatter, satellites, near space, you name it. It's
Not lots of them, but
those were the people who wanted the magazine back very badly and were beating on us to do it.
They're not a big population, but they are a passionate population.
Yes, absolutely. And at the time, back in 2002, it was feasible to bring it back in print as a quarterly. And that worked out pretty well for several years. It never really, from an economic side, it basically held its own. It didn't cost more than it brought in, and it didn't bring in more than it cost.
Very few of us try to run a business on a break-even basis, though.
Exactly.
So kind of got to make money.
And with the overall situation that we were getting into, it became, with the state of the economy, it became infeasible or unfeasible to continue publishing CQVHF as an independent print publication. So we merged that in. World Radio Online, unfortunately, never caught on among the readership.
That was your big experiment in totally online.
Yes.
And that's a publication that you guys bought. It had been an independent for a long time, and then you bought it.
Yes.
Did you move it to digital immediately after you bought it, or did you try running it as a print for a while?
No, we moved it digital immediately. Armin Noble, who was the previous owner and publisher, was going to shut it down. And so we tried to extend its life by purchasing it from him and using it and putting it in digital only. Longtime readers of World Radio will remember that it was printed on newsprint. And it was one of three or four similar publications that Armand published, each in different fields. But as a result, he was able to purchase large amounts of newsprint and get very favorable pricing on that. Pulling any one of those pieces out of the puzzle and trying to publish it on its own, even still with newsprint, was not economically viable in print, because you lost the benefit of that combined circulation and a combined print run. So you lost the benefits there. So it was never feasible for us to continue it as a print publication.
Okay, and it sounds like it didn't do as well as you wanted it to as an online publication either. Standalone.
No, it didn't, which is too bad because the content was fantastic. It was probably the most underappreciated magazine in ham radio.
Yeah, all the magazines that were part of the CQ family had their own separate constituencies. There's some overlap, but they aimed at a specific area of the hobby and of hams, and something for everybody. But I guess in terms of all of them, not enough of everybody's except for the main CQ.
Right. So we pulled that into what we learned in publishing World Radio Online as an online-only magazine is the same thing that has been becoming obvious in the publishing industry as a whole, which is that despite all the talk of digital, 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 from an economic perspective, digital-only publications are not there yet. They don't have the reader support. They don't have the advertising support. Everyone expects everything that they see on the internet to be free, or that they access on the internet to be free,
yep,
or very, very inexpensive. Even when we made it very, very inexpensive, people weren't willing to pay real money to subscribe to World Radio Online or to advertise in it.
Even Newsweek has gone back to a printed publication, which is, that I guess they're sort of an anomaly. Everybody who has gone digital has either stayed that way or gone out of business.
Right.
So I'm not sure what the deal is with Newsweek. We'll see what happens to them. But there are not a lot of analogies between them and a ham radio publication. I think the worlds are pretty different.
What the publishing industry as a whole is learning is that what is working pretty well is what's being called a hybrid publication. And that's exactly what we have with CQ now. Part print, part digital. There is a strong print component and a strong digital component as well. And that seems to be the model that is working best in the whole publishing industry right now. And we're hoping that it works well for us too.
Yeah. Well, there'll be a point where everybody in the audience started young enough and then aged to the point where they've been used to the online stuff. You know, I'm going to be a an anomaly at age 64, much preferring to read things on my Nexus 7 here and online. I've dropped my print QST subscription. My CQ subscriptions were expiring as of March, so I renewed in just the online version. And this is the way I want to see everything. I don't want to pile up a stack of magazines anymore. But I'm at my age, I'm the odd duck. People always say that anyway. But the younger and younger folks are eventually going to come to the point where there'll be that crossover and everything will be digital and no one's going to want something printed on a dead tree anymore. But that's going to be eventually a while, especially for hams.
Now, my 24-year-old daughter still prefers print magazines, even though she's very comfortable with digital as well. So there's going to be a lot of crossover for a while to come here. But I think that there's always going to be a place for print publications, both newspapers and magazines. And I just hope that the economy will permit them to be supported. We'll see where the future takes us in terms of the whole publishing industry, whether print survives, I certainly hope so, or whether everything becomes digital. Certainly, our intention right now is to maintain CQ as a combination print and digital magazine for the foreseeable future.
Do you find that in not just in terms of how it's published, but in what you put into the magazine, do you have to walk a fine line between things that appeal to older hams and things that might appeal to younger hams if you could finally get them to actually pay attention to the magazine?
We look for stuff that's interesting, period, and practical. We're doing a lot, more and more practical projects, and one of the big growth areas that we've been seeing recently is QRP and portable hamming. And we have our Take It to the Field issue in June about getting your station out with you in the woods and hiking and things like that, or going to remote places and operating from there. Those are things that appeal to all ages. So we don't make a conscious effort to appeal to a particular age group. We make a conscious effort to find the most interesting articles and most interesting projects that we can find to publish.
But has your experience been that that young hams or potential young hams really want to see something different? I guess the conventional wisdom is they want to see more computerish stuff and digital stuff, although your young ham of the year last year was what I call an old soul. He liked the old HF and contesting and stuff. But do you see things that make a sharp divide between what might interest very young hams or potential young hams, and I'm talking about teens and 20s, compared to us old farts?
No, because this is primarily a technological hobby. So, yes, people want to see about computers. Young people want to read more computer-oriented stuff, things like Raspberry Pi mini computers and Arduinos and things like that that are all becoming very popular. Well, that's good stuff for a general ham audience, regardless of age. So we're not focused on, will this appeal to a certain age? We're focused on, is this an interesting article for an active ham?
Okay. So I'm hoping that CQ has a good long life and continues and does attract those young hams. And I'm looking forward to seeing all the stuff that I have been getting in three magazines stuffed into one. So, well, not all. I guess I can't
say. I've got to tell you, the first time that I looked at the February CQ Plus, which was on the airplane on my way to Orlando, I was really blown away by it. It was just, I had seen all the bits and pieces. But as you know from the television world, as a producer, you have bits and pieces here and there, and they exist separately. separately and independently, and the process of bringing them all together into a unified being, whether it's a television program or a magazine, creates something that is greater than the sum of its parts. And I was just absolutely blown away by how incredibly great CQ Plus was. Really good stuff. And it just, you know, the magazine just kept going. As you pointed out before, it's 164 pages now, up from 112.
Yeah, I'm going to be spending a lot of time working my way through that. But as I've sampled the articles that I brought in yesterday, a lot of stuff that I want to look at. And that's often not the case in most magazines. You know, cursory article or cursory flip through them, look at what's in there and read one or two. But there's half a dozen meaty articles that I want to get into, and hopefully lots of other people seeing that same thing.
Well, that's always been our focus in all of our magazines, is interesting stuff, practical stuff, stuff that, you know, when I talk to people at HamFest, they constantly tell me that they flip through the other magazine they may get, but they read every page of CQ on a regular basis, and I'm always very gratified to hear that.
Yep. Well, so I'm going to show people. Go ahead.
I just want to update you on a couple of things here to continue the discussion from earlier of where we're at and how we're getting things back on schedule. Just to clarify, we are combining our March and April issues. That's going to be one issue. And that's going to be produced as, both print and digital. We kind of did that at the last minute, so we don't have everything that normally would go into April in that March-April issue. The May issue is not by name, but by content, going to be somewhat of a combined what didn't get into April plus May issue. For example, in the May issue, we're going to have the results of both the single sideband and CW weekends of the CQ Worldwide DX contest. So contesters will be ecstatic over the May issue. Non-contesters will want to look at CQ Plus. but it's just for that one issue that we're going to be scrunching all the contest results together there.
Are you still very committed to publishing in the magazine's contest results as opposed to sticking them online like AWOL has mostly done?
Well, starting last year, we moved the line scores, the individual station scores, onto the web. Our current, because they were just getting out of control. Luckily for us, the CQ Worldwide DX contest and the CQWPX contest are the most popular contests in the world, and they're continuing to grow at wonderful rates. What was happening, though, was that the results were getting completely out of hand. We were running 19 and 20 pages in an issue with contest results. So starting last year, we started shifting the individual score listings off to the web. So what we have now on all of our contests is the usual write-up of who did what and various stories that are relayed to us, and the tables of the top winners in different categories, different continents, things like that. But the pages and pages of individual scores were moved off to our website as of last year.
Did you get any heat about that? Did anybody complain that all the individual scores disappeared?
Very, very small amount.
I mean, what would it take for somebody to be upset at that? They didn't see their call sign in the magazine,
yeah,
I guess.
Basically. And they want to see it in print.
Okay. All right. I want to show folks what the digital edition looks like on the carry it to the library version. Because, that's been one of the things people have wanted to be able to do, is that they want the magazine to be very portable. And this is a Nexus 7. It's the newer version of the Nexus 7. And I just loaded this up last night. that little icon appeared. It's the Zinio icon. And here's the magazine as it appears on the Nexus 7. As you can see, it is very responsive for turning pages, maybe even a little more responsive than the version was that we were looking at a minute ago online. I can zoom almost as much as I want, and that's been one of my big complaints with QSTs online, is they have a fixed level of zoom, and it was fixed, Rich, at the level of somebody with eyes who is 32 years old, not 64 years old.
You know, one of the things that I have found with the digital edition, and, you know, I think that Zinio formats it and primarily they've optimized the presentation for tablets. If you're looking at it on a laptop or a desktop computer, it's going to be a little on the slow and clunky side. But if you're looking at it on a tablet, whether it's like you've got or an iPad like I have, it is incredible, both in terms of the quality of what you're seeing, the ability to zoom. Like you, my vision isn't what it used to be. And the ability to zoom in and read stuff at a higher, larger image size and higher resolution is great. Plus, of course, we have the benefit of live links to websites that are reported in articles or to advertiser websites. If you want to learn more about a product, you just tap it and away you go. These are our magazines are optimized for tablets, and tablets are portable and they will go to the library with you. I think that, you know, there are certainly as many benefits to it as drawbacks. There are many times that I find I prefer the looking at the digital edition. But I got to admit, looking at it on my tablet is the way to do it. Trying to look at it on my desktop or laptop is often an exercise in frustration. But yeah, you can't have everything.
And you can print the pages if you want, if you need something, yes, as a hard copy. One of the nice things that I see about this version is that I can download it onto the tablet. It took QST a while to be able to do that for Android. They started that way with iOS, but took a while for Android. Then when this tablet, and this is a fairly rare bird, it's at the current KitKat version 4.4 of Android, and that broke QST for a little while, and they got that fixed. Zinio was up to date as soon as I started looking at it anyway. It didn't have any problem in downloading it. None of them are perfect. There are interface issues I would like to see done a little bit different here and there. I'd like to see QST have better zoom capability. So I'm not I'm not a total fanboy of every one of them, but as an overall experience, I'm finding myself pretty happy with seeing things online here. One thing I did have a question on, and don't know if you've got an instant answer, is that I've been a subscriber for a long time, but I went to the Zinio site to sign up for this, which is, I think, what you recommend doing if you want to see things right away without a couple of day delay. And that didn't seem to know anything about my history with CQ, so there's no access to the digital edition archives. And is that something I can get? Or is that just, I start now with digital and archives are single issue. They're available to buy as single issues, but not as apparently part of my current subscription.
Yeah, to the best of my knowledge, your personal library begins with the issue at which your subscription begins. And you always have access to those copies and those issues. But I do not believe that it includes back issues.
Okay, so there's one area that QST and AWOL have an advantage on you. That's if you go... Well, if you're a member of AWOL, you can get all the digital stuff, no extra charge, and all the archives and libraries available to you. But if you could do that, if you could afford to do that, you probably would. I don't think you're withholding it from anybody because you're just a Grinch. That would be my guess.
That is correct.
All right. So is there anything else about the current situation at CQ that you would like to talk about? I imagine that you've had some very intense editorial and business meetings trying to hammer this stuff out. None of it's open for the public scrutiny, but we'll just look at your face for a moment and say, this was painful.
The old Chinese curse, may you live in interesting times.
You've
been living in interesting times.
Yeah.
But I'm confident that we're getting through them and that we're going to have an even better product on the other side of it.
I just want to say
thank you to our readers for their patience and their understanding, and extend our apologies for these delays. And hopefully we will be back on schedule as of the May issue and be able to stay there for the foreseeable future.
And probably starting the CQ television show is a ways off in the future then.
Most likely.
Yep. All right. So let's wrap this thing up. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. He is
Rich Moseson, W2VU.
I was going to give you the opportunity to do the sign-off, the over and out thing, but considering the circumstances that CQ is in right now, you might not want to say those words.
You're absolutely right. I'll let you sign off your show.
Okay. So I will mention one more time, because we exist on the kindness of audience as well. Arvin is sitting back there. Arvin is our chief financial officer. He would love to hear from you. If you enjoy these programs, get some value out of them, please stop by our website, hamradionow.tv. Stop by CQ. What's the deal with the dash? Why is it CQ
dash? At the time
dash?
That we were getting our web domain, which now is ancient history, that seemed to be the
way to do it.
Most available site name, CQ.com, was already gone. Congressional Quarterly had that, unfortunately.
Yeah, who the heck are they? So it's dash, CQ-amateur-radio.com. Stop there and sign up for print, digital. You don't care. You'll take either one, right?
That's right.
All right. Thanks for watching 73. I will say it because we're going to stick around. Over and out.